Hello, everyone. We are entering into worship in this moment where the world keeps turning and our hearts keep yearning to be part, to be ever part of love. This is our last pre-record service, hopefully forever. And for those of you who have joined us from outside of this little local community, I wanted to say thank you. Thank you for journeying with us. Thank you for reaching out to me with emails and letters, encouraging me and this community of St. Andrews with this adventure of online worship. It's been profoundly helpful to feel like we are joined by people in other places and spaces in this work of paying attention. So thank you. And for the rest of you, I'll see you next week. I'll see you next week on site, doubly vaxxed, ready to mask, ready for love. So let us worship. Let us pay attention in this moment to our wild cosmic spirit, whom we know as God.
We gather together to worship on the land of the Wurundjeri people. As we gather, we acknowledge that the Wattle, the Cockatoo, and this bend in the Birrarung River was taken without consent or negotiation. We give our respect to their elders, past, present, and emerging, and we pledge ourselves to work alongside these First Peoples to achieve a just future for all.
Today's reading comes from Mark chapter 12, verses 38 to 44. And Jesus said, "Beware of the scribes who like to walk around in long robes and to be greeted with respect in the marketplaces and to have the best seats in the synagogues and the places of honor at banquets. They devour widows' houses and for the sake of appearances say long prayers. They will receive the greater condemnation. And he sat down opposite the treasury and watched the crowd putting money into the treasury. Many rich people put in large sums, and a poor widow came and put in 2 small copper coins. So Jesus called his friends and said to them, "Truly I tell you, this poor widow has put in more than all of those who are contributing to the treasury, for all of them have contributed out of their abundance. But she, out of her poverty, has put in everything she had and all she had to live on." These are the words of faith.
In the outer forecourt at the temple in Jerusalem stood Jesus and his 12 disciples. They had been here many times before, and it was the perfect place to talk, think, question, and ponder. And as they stood talking, thinking, questioning, and pondering, they watched as people came in and out, out and into the forecourt, all giving their offerings to the temple treasury. And then at one point throughout the day, they all stopped and stared as a very impressive person walked in. A rich merchant made a slow, commanding walk through the forecourt. He directed everyone's attention with his robe made of the finest cloth in bright colours. And as he slowly and importantly walked his way through the forecourt, he held in his hand a bag filled with coins. And when he finally got to the treasury, he made a big show of taking 1, 2, 3, 4, and more coins from his bag. And when finally it was empty and the sound of the noise of coins stopped, turned around to check everyone was watching him, and then slowly and importantly walked back through the forecourt in his robe of the finest cloth and in the brightest colours. And after that rich merchant had left, everyone went back about their business, until something caught Jesus' eye, and he turned and saw a little old woman, and he called attention to his disciples to look as this little old woman, hobbling with a cane, in a robe that was patched and patched and patched again, went across to the treasury, clutching something in her hand. And finally, she got to the treasury. She dropped 1, 2 pennies into the treasury. And when the sound of them bouncing about stopped, she clutched her robe that was patched and patched and patched again, and hobbled back out into the city on her cane. "Tell me," said Jesus to his disciples, "of everyone we've seen today, walking in and out, out and in, who do you think has given the most?" "Well, that's easy," said one of his disciples. "It was that rich merchant. I mean, you saw how he walked in. He commanded everyone's attention. He was so rich and powerful and made a big show of how many gold coins he put in. I mean, he probably put more in today than everyone else combined. He gave the most." "Huh. What about that little old woman?" asked Jesus.
"Her? She barely gave anything," said one of the other disciples. "She took forever to walk in her robe that was patched and patched and patched again, and she only gave a penny or two."
"Huh. Do you want to know what I think?" asked Jesus.
"Of course, teacher," said his 12 disciples.
"Well, I think the person who gave the most today was that little old woman."
"What?"
"Oh, yeah. Think about it. That rich merchant made a big show as he walked into the forecourt. He can afford rich clothes and probably has a fine house. And he probably makes more than he gave today in a week. And sure, he gave a lot of money to the temple and it will go to good things, but he wanted everyone to know exactly how much he was giving. He's the sort of person that will demand or expect the most important seats in the synagogue or the best plate at the feast. But that little old woman, in a robe that had been patched and patched and patched again, probably given everything she owes to the temple. Those 2 pennies are probably more than she'll make in a very long time. If she doesn't have food at home, she's going to starve. That little old woman, she gave the most today. She gave her whole life. And then Jesus and his 12 disciples went back to watching people come in and out and in to the forecourt as they began talking, thinking, questioning, and pondering.
So there's this little girl, and she's lost, and everyone is looking for her, and her mother can't even breathe anymore. And the father, well, he feels his heart beating in his chest, beating like wild horses, and he wants to like break something, but instead he holds his young wife, and she holds their baby. And together they look out over the endless blue and the burning orange oblivion of West Australia. And together they call their daughter's name. And the people, they are looking, they are everywhere. They gather the police and the army and the bush trackers and the rescue squads and the dogs and the drones and the farmers and the neighbours. Everyone's out, quad scars, everyone. They're all searching. They all give their might. They all give the tiny bit that they can give, and together, these tiny bits, these pieces of a puzzle, they add up to a picture. And the puzzle is solved. And in a locked house, in a locked room, a little girl is found. What's your name, sweetheart? What's your name, darling? What's your name? Cleo? So there are pilgrims and they are walking. They have walked across 6 countries. And many of them are old and they carry packs and they sleep in churches. They're walking towards Glasgow. They bring what they can, their breath, their bones, their beating hearts, to try and influence this big conversation that is happening. This big conversation to stop the destruction of the earth. They give what they can. They give their might. So there is this widow, and she gives what she can. It's not much. And she says, oh, it wasn't much. I mean, it's not much at all, really. I know this. I was almost ashamed, actually, of how little it was. I almost didn't go to the temple that day. I almost stayed at home. I mean, it's hard to believe that your little bit can make a difference, isn't it? Hard to imagine. I mean, all those other gifts, they're so great, aren't they? Gifts of money and time and personality, all those fine words that fill the air. And what I had to give was, it was nothing, really. But I gave it. And then he was there. That one that you call the prophet. The one that's causing all the fuss around here. And he looked at me and he said, "This woman has given everything. She's given everything." Well, I don't know about that. But still, it was nice, wasn't it? Nice to be acknowledged, nice to be seen. Is that what this story is about? It's pretty traditional understanding of the story. This woman, the woman who gives her all, and we praise her for it. Jesus praises her for it. She gave everything. Well, maybe. Or maybe not. According to African American theologian Debbie Thomas, this story is not about praising the widow for giving her all. She asks the question, what tone of voice did Jesus speak when he spoke of that woman? What tone of voice did he use? It's an interesting question. I mean, traditionally, we've always heard Jesus say, "Oh, look at the widow," in an approving sort of way, haven't we? Look at the widow. But what if it wasn't? What if it wasn't approving, but it was more like a tone of horror, of a kind of grief, of a despair, more like, look at the widow. She, out of her poverty, has given everything that she has to live on. And actually, if we think about it, it does make more sense that Jesus' tone would have been one of horror. For here is this woman, the poorest of them all, giving the last of what she has to support a religious system which is what? Which has punished the poorest, sneered at the vulnerable. And here she is, our woman, giving to the very institution which Jesus has just declared to be run by people who are devourers of widows' houses. In a way, Jesus is watching this widow participate in her own devouring. It's like she has bought the lies that the powers that be have sold her, and that she, like so many of us, has become a participant to a structure that Jesus believes should actually be thrown down. So, what lies have you bought recently? What lies have we as an Australian people bought recently? Oh, I don't know. What about, here's a good one. The lie that Scott Morrison has a climate policy. Apparently, he's got a plan. He's not going to show us the plan, but he's got a plan, and he'll give us the plan maybe sometime down the future. Yeah, that's very true. What about, I know. The lie of Barnaby Joyce. The lie of Barnaby Joyce, who pretends that he represents the farmers when actually he represents the fossil fuel industry. What about the lie that we need clearly more coal, more mines, more gas? What are the other lies? The lie that we must all be busy? Busy, busy, busy all the time. How have you been? Oh, busy. Yes, me too. So busy. What about the lie of endless consumption? Did you see them lined up at midnight? Can't wait to get into Kmart to buy some more plastic. What the hell is going on? What about the lie that you can fix everything? You can. You can fix everything and save everyone. I never fall for that lie. What about the lie that there's not enough? There's not enough, so we have to hoard and we have to hold on and we have to... What about the lie that when you're old, you're redundant? What about that lie? What about the lie that life has no meaning? No higher purpose, so to hell with it all. Burn, baby, burn. What lies have you participated in recently? So what are we to take away from this story? Well, in the words of Debbie Thomas, we can take away Jesus noticing the widow. Jesus notices the widow. He pays her attention. And he sees what everyone else is too busy and too grand and too spiritual and too self-absorbed to see. And in seeing, well, this is the redemptive part of the story. That Jesus, his eyes are ever on the small and on the insignificant and on the hidden. Like a lost girl in the desert. Like a small and ragged and humble group of disciples walking in the wind to try and save the world. And he reminds us with his noticing that everything is precious. And that while everyone, all of us, can find ourselves unwittingly participating in the oppression of our world, everyone, all of us, can also wake up with the help of each other to be part of this glorious turning towards love. Because when we put all our tiny pieces of might, the widow's might, together, we can do anything. What's your name, darling? What's your name?
bit tired, but quite okay. It has its ups and downs, but I'm very encouraged by all the hospitality and the encouragement that we meet from people on the way. I mean, we've been sleeping in mostly in churches, parish halls, and so many parish members have met us in these 5 different countries. Scotland is the 6th that we walk in, and they have really encouraged us to walk on and to carry the message. So yeah, many people feel for climate justice and want this message to their politicians to be heard.
Our Father, who art in heaven, you are also at home in the air, the soil, the forests, and the oceans. Hallowed be your name. By the care we take of your creation, your kingdom come. All that you see is good. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Your will to till and care. Give us this day our daily bread, that all may have sufficient to live life in fullness. Forgive us our trespasses, our greed, our exploitation, our lack of concern for other species and future generations, as we forgive those who trespass against us. By reconciliation with justice and peace, lead us not into temptation. The temptation to equate dominion with exploitation. And deliver us from evil. The evil of destroying your gift of creation. For yours is the kingdom. Yours, Lord, not ours. The power and the glory. In the cross and the resurrection. Forever and ever. You are the beginning, and you are the end. Amen. And so it be.
An uncomfortable blessing. May the Spirit bless you with discomfort at all easy answers and half-truths, so that you will live out of your heart and into the world. May the Spirit bless you with tears, to weep with those who suffer, so that you will reach out with all your resources. May the Spirit bless you with foolishness, to think that you could possibly, yes, you, make a difference with all the things that everybody else says can never be done. May the Spirit bless you and your hands and your feet and your heart and your song, so that you too, my loves, can be part of joining in with a great Alleluia chorus for the whole world. This day and all days, may the Spirit bless you.